Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode number 182 of the show. We hope you're all staying distant and healthy in these trying times. I wanted to just, before the show, let you know that we have a news segment at the beginning of this episode. We recorded this about a week and a half ago or so. The news item is specifically about how COVID-19 is affecting the Hollywood industry. Obviously, things change on a dime. Literally like 2 days after we recorded this, all hell sort of broke loose here in the U.S. So you'll have to take what we say in the news segment with a grain of salt, as things have changed so rapidly. So I just wanted to let you folks know that obviously, what we talk about in the news isn't exactly the case anymore. Without further ado, though, let's move into episode 182. Hey folks, what's happening? Welcome to episode number 182 of the Flixation Podcast. Thanks for hanging out throughout the hiatus. We hope you enjoyed our wrap-up of 2019 in film. My name, Eric Madsen. You can find me on Twitter, Hazer75. I'm here at Flixation Studios, P City, Wisco. Joined tonight from Denver, Colorado, the Minister. Minister, welcome back.
Yeah, happy to be here. I think winter might be over here, which is exciting. I'm not entirely sure. I think I'm maybe 3 or 4 days from having been here one full year. And I know my fourth day here last year, they had that bomb cyclone thing they talked about, and I lost my power. But I don't know. I looked at the forecast, and it, you know, today was touching 70. It's still almost 60 outside, just beautiful, and it doesn't look like it's going to drop again. So I had to do a beer audible due to the temperature change, so we can get to that later. But it feels like it, with the sun out and it being 70, it felt like summer again. Like I was putting on suntan lotion today as I went outside, so I didn't burn. Or not suntan lotion, sunscreen, so I did not burn. So it's a... It was a quick shift, and I really hope it's here to stay.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've never known you to be a suntan kind of guy. So what's in that Colorado weed? I don't know.
Yeah.
Robert Gassaway, Phoenix, Arizona. Robert, welcome.
Yeah, you would think I would be a suntan guy, but living in Arizona, but it doesn't happen. It was like 84 today. Gorgeous day outside. Got out early, but then went to watch a movie. So as usual, stay in. Indoors, watching movies, staying out of the heat.
Yeah, it's actually, speaking of heat, for me here in Peace City, Wisco, it's supposed to be 61 tomorrow. I'm definitely not bold enough to predict the end of the winter here, but things are looking up. Well, things as a whole probably aren't looking up. But we got one thing we're going to talk about. We're going to bring back the news segment here at the top of the show for a bit. We're going to be talking about Birds of Prey, the Harley Quinn thing. I know there's a big exorbitant title there, but I forgot to put that in front of me right now. But we will get to that in a few minutes. And we'll be talking about a film from 1984 called A Brother from Another Planet. So that is the show tonight. Maybe some other stuff from 2020 in a quick fix at the end. Contact the show, flixationpodcast@gmail.com. Call or text the voicemail line, 608-535-9302. Or just follow us on Facebook. Please give us a lofty star rating or a quick review in the store of your choice. Help folks find the Flixation Podcast. you know, this is affecting everybody, so why not the theater industry? And it looks like it could be a really rough time for the theater industry here. The coronavirus, guys, COVID-19, wreaking all kinds of havoc around the world, especially in China right now, specifically. China, of course, the number two movie market in the world. China shutting down a lot of theaters. I don't think there's much going in China for public events right now at all. So, yeah, that's a blow to the money stream here for the American film industry. The biggest example of that right now is Disney's live-action remake of Mulan that was specifically geared towards Chinese audiences, obviously, with subject matter. They shut down theaters right around the time of the release of the film. It is running in the U.S. Not doing real well here. What's the movie industry to do facing uncertainty, especially for the summer? Who knows how much longer? We saw the James Bond film that was slated for a May release get pushed to Thanksgiving as they did not want to risk the waters at this point. So, scheduled in the summer, guys, lots of tentpole films here, big blockbuster stuff. Black Widow, slated for early May. F9 is Memorial Day weekend. Wonder Woman 1984, June 5th. Top Gun Maverick, June 24th. All big films, all cost over $200 million to make. And all hope to utilize both movie markets, the U.S. and China. So, what are they going to do? Are they going to keep it up? Sporting events, that kind of thing, all over the world getting canceled right now. South by Southwest Festival just canceled completely for this year as well. The double-edged attack here that they're worried of is people relying too much on home streaming services. I think the cat's out of the bag on those, but they fear that people will just, this will push people towards not going to the theater anymore. Wanted to throw it to Robert first. Robert, because you've really been, out of us three especially, you've been out and about in the theater scene, seeing lots of things. So I'm curious, is there any real residual effect that you've seen for the coronavirus, or still seem pretty business as usual over there for the theaters?
Yeah, it's been business as usual. You know, there's not enough cases locally for people to really be worried about going out and going about their normal business. But I think as it spreads, which seems inevitable at this point, I think that you're just going to hear people coughing in the theater, and you wonder right away, how close am I to this person? What if they have it? People are going to be strategic about, I want to go see Black Widow, but let me go to a time where I think there'll be very few people in the theater. I think you're right about the streaming services. Maybe this is where people switch to just start watching old movies. As we always say, old movies rule. So new movies are going to have to be postponed just in an effort to, I mean, what's the overarching goal of postponing big events or canceling big events is to slow down the spread until there's a vaccine for it. And so people are going to be down for that plan. If they can cut down on going out in public, then they will. But you're right. I'm always going to, like, you know, just this weekend, I've been to an art show, and last weekend to a basketball game. I'm always in crowds and art festivals, food festivals. I love that kind of stuff. So I've been going to that a lot right now because we don't really know how much freedom we'll have to do that in the coming months. But I'm not really panicked or anything. It's just, you know, kind of concerning that it's out there. But think about watching A Quiet Place and people start coughing and stuff, the effects of being in a movie. Or think about the movies that are coming in a couple of years based on this outbreak. You know, it's made me think about the Soderbergh Contagion movie, which I really liked. You know, this could be something that's represented in film because it's that big of an event.
It's not like you can move all these summer movies to Thanksgiving or Christmas or whatever. They have to be spread out, right? So this is going to be weird.
Yeah, I have a bunch of kind of barely connected points on this. So Robert's saying people are still going to the movies here right now. Of course, that can change quickly, but it's not really playing in China, as you said. So I think the first thing to do is, while these blockbusters are playing here but will not play China, this gives us the chance to make them very, very gay. So let's make them all super gay, because they can play in theaters that way, unlike when they play in China. So we don't have to make all these edits to appeal to the Chinese government. So let's make Black Widow the gayest superhero movie of all time, I guess. So that's the first great idea I have. But
I'm listening.
Yeah. I don't know who else is in that. I don't know if that'll get you excited or not. But this is a weird thing to navigate because, well, the first thing I noticed is weeks ago, every day I go on Watch Just Watch or Let's Watch This or something, and I see like every streaming movie on every service I have that became available that day. And you bet, Contagion and Outbreak were new additions in the last few weeks. So if people are hiding at home to get away from coronavirus, apparently they want to watch movies. They think they want to watch movies about epidemics. That's kind of surprising to me. Mm. But they have all shown up, and I don't know how many people are aching for the movie Outbreak without this, but it is there.
I mean, I really liked Contagion, but I'd never want to see it again.
So. That was the first one to show up, and that was probably a month ago, or I'm pretty sure. So it's there. Yeah, this is weird because I'm not. So I am a hypochondriac, so that comes into play. But generally, you know, I'm not afraid of this stuff. I think if you look at the numbers, I mean, flu is what you should be afraid of. Yeah. Flu's not new, so it's less scary, but that's should be much, much scarier, the amount of people that die of something like that. So, there's a realism to it. So, but on top of that, then my wife, I think you interacted about this, Eric, but my wife was talking toilet paper crisis in the city. So I did run to the grocery store today to make sure we had plenty of toilet paper, which there was plenty. So I guess I'm not afraid, but I do want to have toilet paper. I'm kind of up on this stuff because I work for the state of Colorado, so I get all these updates constantly. But I don't know, like if there's a movie playing, you know, I'm going to go and I'm not afraid of that. But there is that hint of things in your everyday life in the same way maybe 3-4 years ago after the Aurora movie theater shootings were. Like, you're going to go to a movie, but it's in you, the back of your head somewhere. So when I go buy guacamole made at the grocery store and I'm eating it and I'm enjoying it, I have like that 1% worry that I'm getting coronavirus while eating it. So that's about the impact for me, and I'm guessing that's most people. But I don't know. Yeah, I don't know where we're headed. There's a lot of movies that could be moved that I wasn't going to see anyway. So this might be a straight streaming podcast, and that might work well for you and me, Eric.
Yeah.
But, it's terrible for Robert. So he needs like a big projector.
I think I heard that one or two productions either of TV or film got halted because of the spread of COVID-19, maybe in Canada, where they shoot a lot of stuff. But if it spreads more, then it could have an impact like the writer's strike did a few years ago, where they struck for over half a year. I think it was like 9 months or so. So if this is a similar, it could have that impact where it's like the faucet of film coming to us could be shut off to a trickle or to some degree because of this. So that's another angle to watch on it.
We'll just get all those movies they shelved over the years that are still there. Oh, like, we're going to get that New Mutants movie. And
love it.
Who knows? I don't know what else has been shelved, but there's been plenty, I'm sure.
I will say, too, that isn't the 1% thought of getting COVID-19 from the store-made guacamole does seem better than the usual 10% feeling I'm going to get dysentery from it. So that's an improvement.
I mean, there's really good guacamole about a mile from my house. I don't know. I mean, it might be worth that 10%. And I have enough sick paid sick time that I can weather the dysentery.
Yep. Biggest worry for something like that would be children. Does not seem to affect children that bad. So I'm in the public. I'm out in the public all the time at work. So it is what it is. Like you said, if there's something in the theater I want to see, I'm going to see it. What are you going to do? The way things are going worldwide, it's going to be a tough call. And who knows how, I don't know if even 3 or 4 months is enough to hope this thing works its way through. They're just learning how to treat it now. So I don't know, guys. It could be a while. Now, if you listen to the president, most people just don't even report it because it's no big deal and they just keep on going to work. So kudos to them. Don't go to work if you have coronavirus, Robert. Don't listen to the president. All right, so what do you say? Let's talk about our first film of the evening. This one, new a couple of weeks ago. I don't know, marketing not good. I don't know if the coronavirus also had something to do with this, but kind of got buried. Not much action here with this one. So not a big take home for Birds of Prey and the Fantabulous Emancipation of One Harley Quinn. After splitting with the Joker, Harley joins superheroes Black Canary, Huntress, and Renee Montoya to save a young girl from an evil crime lord. This one stars Margot Robbie, Rosie Perez, and Mary Elizabeth Winstead. And it is directed by Kathy Yan. I guess this is in the DC universe. Nothing much crosses over in this universe, to be honest. So I guess that's not all that important. Spin off of Suicide Squad here, which as I was trying to put together my thoughts on this movie after I saw it, except for the Jared Leto stuff, I cannot remember a thing about Suicide Squad. I mean, I remember Will Smith was in it, and I do remember the Native American guy getting killed in like the first 6 minutes.
I mean, there was really quality Captain Boomerang in that, in case you forgot.
I remember us talking about that, but I could not remember anything. Nothing. I couldn't remember anything. So I did like that film, sort of, but it didn't leave that much of an impression on me, I guess. Had some mixed feelings going into this, as you know, not much has worked out in this universe, the cinematic universe, so far. Couldn't remember Suicide Squad for the life of me. As a comic reader, man, I really loved The Birds of Prey, a book I looked forward to every month. Typically the iteration I'm talking about would have been Barbara Gordon and Black Canary and the Huntress, mostly just the three lady team. Harley came later, kind of hooked up with them at the end of my run of reading the book. So I had a curiosity about this, I guess. WB or CW or TV, I think it's a defunct network, but one of those bad side networks had a Birds of Prey series that was not good at all. I don't think it made it through the first season, so hasn't been handled very well so far. Margot Robbie, she was enjoyable, I guess, as Harley Quinn in the Suicide Squad film. So the film was silly, pretty unrealistic, but in a comic way. So I think director Kathy Yan kind of pulls that off. Don't think characters are handled very seriously. It turned out to be way jokier than I expected. And I think ultimately it ended up working. Pretty sure I like this a little better than I liked Suicide Squad. I don't know if that's the popular opinion, probably not, but I actually had a pretty good time with this film for the most part. I really like what she did with the fight scenes here. I mean, completely comic booky, over the top, ridiculous fight scenes. I don't know how this former psychiatrist turned Joker sidekick fights like this. I mean, she doesn't in any other iteration I've ever seen. So just completely batshit bonkers. But it was fun. It was fun. She's the only real interesting character here, I think. Actually, Black Canary does turn out to be pretty interesting as well. I don't think Huntress is handled well. I don't think Renee Montoya is handled very well. Bar's kind of low as far as these DC Cinematic Universe films go. So I think it's one of the better ones, honestly. So plot is okay. Gives you Ewan McGregor as Roman Cicero, this villain called Black Mask, whose personal assistant is Victor Zsasz. Most people know as a Batman villain, the serial killer guy. So take a different angle with him than we're used to, but I think it ended up paying off. McGregor's pretty good here as this mustache-twirling rich guy. Kind of the perfect storm of... It's a weird perfect storm, but it ends up working out for me. It's not going to be a sky-high rating, but kind of funny, kind of entertaining. I don't know. What did you think, Rep?
I think I liked it a little bit more than you, Eric. I thought it was funny and fun. I thought there were some really interesting things going on here because the popular opinion I've seen is that people like this a lot more than Suicide Squad.
Oh, really?
Like that movie. Yeah, that movie tanked so hard. It has like a low rating on all the major aggregate sites. It was just panned.
Oscar-winning Suicide Squad.
Yes. But to have a sequel come out of that was not something that could have predicted. And I think when Margot Robbie secured that deal, like she made the pitch for that, for adapting it, she really has got a lot of creative control. And she's, from what I hear, she's like really managing her production career really well. But I think she's great in this role. And the fact that they have Kathy Yan directing, there's like several women directors coming into comic book movies over the last few years and in production right now. But I don't think any of them are as virtually unknown as Kathy Yan. She has like a short film and some tiny film to her name. And the casting here, I didn't like Ewan McGregor as like this twisted comic book villain. I have no background to the comic books. I didn't really know that this was a thing before it was a movie idea. I didn't know that this storyline existed. I like Chris Messina as an actor, but I was just so puzzled by seeing him play this deranged, villainous lapdog for Ewan McGregor. I just would not picture him in that role, but I kind of enjoyed it. He's having fun with it. And McGregor is too, but it just didn't work for me. I don't want to see him as a comic book villain. I just think they could have gotten somebody more interesting. Yeah, I think Journey Smollett as Black Canary and Mary Elizabeth Winstead are both really interesting in their characters, especially the crossbow-wielding assassin hellbent on revenge. But she's so like awkward around people after she has her hit list. This reminded me a lot of Deadpool and the team that he put together in his last movie. The style of comedy going on in this. And I think that's pretty much what I expected from, I think Harley Quinn was by far the standout of Suicide Squad. Like, she's the only thing I liked about that movie, the way it was played. And this movie delivers on that. It follows through on that. Plus they have Matthew Labatique. You know, he's the music video director who's done tons of films with Aronofsky. And he's shooting fights in a unique way here, Eric. I'm sure you saw like that sliding camera move, but when people are fighting, the camera is in between them and it slides from one to the other without cutting. So you can tell it's really the actors that are fighting.
I think that fight stuff is all great.
Yeah.
I mean, if you can swat it, you know, if you're willing just to swallow how ridiculous and unrealistic it is, I think it's great. It's much smoother than your typical stylized fighting and shit. And it's so creative what they're doing with these people. I think it's kind of this brilliant blend of camera trickery and choreography. It's really good.
Yeah, it has kind of a surreal feeling to it. But I liked that and the animated opening, which it looks like Gennady Tartakovsky, who does like Dexter's Laboratory and that kind of stuff. It's like that style of animation. And then Harley Quinn's like tongue-in-cheek narration throughout that tells you that this is really campy and fake and funny. It's campy. I don't think it's as funny as Deadpool, but it has better acting. Like Margot Robbie is great in this. I don't think we've seen her play an asshole and Harley Quinn portrays, you know, an asshole here. Like, everyone in Gotham hates her, except the audience. Like, we're still rooting for her. But I'm really impressed with Margot Robbie in this, after seeing her in that Tonya Harding movie a couple of years ago, and some others that I don't catch all of hers, like Bombshell or Mary, Queen of Scots, but I can tell that she's pushing herself in different directions, and she's kind of on that fast trajectory. And not many actors on that path are successful in a comic book film the way she has, in supporting role in Suicide Squad, and then coming through with a film that most people seem to like, people that have seen it. And it's kind of like an assembly movie, like, let's get the team together, let's get the gang together. But it goes about it so slowly and unintentionally. Like, Harley's not trying to work with these girls. They're not trying to work with her until a certain moment where they kind of have to. And even then, it's not just so easy that it just snaps into place. They kind of don't know how to be in a team. They're bad at it because they're all of the same mindset. And yeah, you can feel that's like, that it's kind of leaning into the girl power stuff. Sometimes the way that Captain Marvel did, I like that film about the same as this one, which is solid, like, you know, mid to upper tier of MCU. And this one, I think Harley Quinn has to be the second best DC movie that's come out after Wonder Woman. So yeah, I liked it probably more than I expected to.
Definitely more than I expected to like it. Rosie Perez, I don't know, not delivering here for me. Robert, how about you?
I just liked her character, but just being, well, casting Rosie Perez as a cop and like one that's like getting kicked off the police force, that's funny to me in like a Brooklyn Nine-Nine kind of way. That's how I took it. And then they put her name up like in superhero lettering, but it's just, you know, whatever her name is. Yeah, I thought, I always like seeing, she's an actress I like seeing in just about any movie she pops up. Like, I've always been a Rosie Perez fan, so I was cool with it.
I mean, I have a lot of exposure with all these characters over the years, but I don't know, this is nothing like the Renee Montoya I know, but...
Okay.
I'm specifically saying I just didn't really, Rosie Perez didn't really do much for me in this, as, not ruining the character or whatever, but just, I did love that t-shirt though, that she's walking around
with. Yeah, that was great.
Very funny, well, very funny.
How about the scene I'll call the Funhouse fight? It had this vibes of, yeah, like Joel Schumacher's Batman and Robin movies, like very campy, jumping off these strange funhouse things. I didn't actually like that scene. I thought it was kind of creative, and like it makes you like sit up in your seat and kind of cock your head after, because it stands out from the scenes around it. But overall, I did not enjoy the scene, just like I didn't enjoy the Joel Schumacher Batman movies, but it's very much on that vibe.
I hear you on that, but I did enjoy that scene. I just, yeah, all the fight choreography is really good. And of course, you're going to be in a funhouse setting if you're going to go find one of the Joker's old lairs and have a brawl. Why the hell not? So are you in, I guess we're both then in for like a sequel to this, or I honestly don't know where the DCU goes from here.
I think she could be almost a stand-in for the Joker. You can't put Joker in everything, but he's such a great villain. And I really noticed watching this that Harley Quinn as a character is not, she's not the female version of the Joker. Like, there are some comparable traits, character traits between them, but I don't think they're meant to just, I think they just show how compatible they are to a certain degree. But she has her own arc and her own relationships. And she doesn't really remind me of any characters on the MCU roster. Like, they don't have a Harley Quinn. I think so DC should lean into that. Let's give, I don't know what it would be, if it'd be just a team up movie or do something more creative or more, I don't know, maybe not a crossover, maybe prequel, or I don't know, but I trust Margot Robbie at this point.
I mean, I know we had Affleck, what, for like 7 seconds in Suicide Squad, so that Affleck Batman was in there. I say you can get rid of that. I don't know why these particular characters that I all like, and with that mild exception of Rosie Perez, I'd like, you know, move these in with the Pattinson Batman thing, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
I like him that much, so.
Well, there is a Suicide Squad 2 coming out, right? Taika Waititi is,
oh, really?
In it. Yeah. And
it's a James Gunn thing, right?
James Gunn movie, right.
That's right.
Some other actor they got. Is Idris Elba somebody?
Okay.
Well, yeah, Will Smith's not in it. No,
oh. I can't remember.
So maybe Alba is Deadshot or whatever. I don't know. But Ian, any questions?
Yeah, well, I was just, did you guys, I think I've seen maybe one trailer or piece of something on the Wonder Woman movie. Have you guys caught a trailer for that?
No, not one.
Second. Yeah, I've caught like half a trailer.
Do you get the sense that DC is making a choice across the board to be lighter? Because that had a lighter tone, right, than DC's used to, this Wonder Woman trailer, or not?
I remember hearing that the first Wonder Woman was, the reshoots were focused on lightening it up after the success of whatever Marvel movie coming out right before that.
And this,
it was too dark. And so, they've been going lighter since then. Even the Justice League was lighter than it was.
Yeah, it didn't. That was like, fell very flat in that way. But I got the sense like a lot of the Wonder Woman was like, let's laugh at the 80s type thing. And I don't know how much that's in play. I don't know if that's a good thing or bad. I'm just wondering if this signals like a change in direction continued. Like if they're, maybe they're just going to make all separate movies and they'll all be their own thing. Or if this is like a concerted effort to lighten things up like Marvel did. So, because you guys seem to think this was a nice change from.
A direct result. I mean, Deadpool really gave multiple studios the permission to make R-rated comic book movies. Or plus Logan, whatever else has come out since then. And this is, I think, probably the second best one after Deadpool for me. Or I like Logan better, but. As far as comedies, it's right behind Deadpool.
They did make a good use of the R rating here, too. So when the violence was over the top, it was way over the top. And it was great.
I mean, remember, Kick-Ass did that almost a decade ago at this point with the playful R-rated action comedy, like superhero thing. But I don't know that... I mean, I have a hard time even thinking about that movie because the second one is one of the worst movies I've ever seen in my life.
It's terrible.
And so that guy's, and he's making a movie that comes out, and I think we must not be seeing it, but I think it's only a podcast is or something. Like, oh no. Maybe he made Brahms The Boy 2 or something. I can't remember. Jeff fucking Wadlow. You're dead to me, Jeff. Jeff Wadlow. Yeah, I think I'll catch up with this at some point. I'm interested enough. Truth, Fantasy Island, Jeff Wadlow. They did talk about that.
Mm. Fantasy Island.
Lucky that. And Kick Ass.
Blumhouse's Fantasy Island.
Oh, right. Yeah.
All right. So, Robert, letterboxed style rating for Birds of Prey.
It gets 3.5 for me, actually. I think I had that much fun with it. Yeah. I was surprised.
All right, fair enough. 3.5 from me as well. All right, that brings us into the What You Drinking segment here on the Flixation podcast. Let's go to Robert Gassaway. Robert, what you drinking?
I got my tequila on the rocks, the smooth Don Julio Añejo. It was a hot day in Phoenix in early March, so got to cool off with some aged tequila. Very smooth.
Ian, the minister, what you drinking?
Yeah, well, I decided if I'm going to drink beer and watch soccer 5 days a week that I cannot just continue to buy $11 six-packs forever. I understand that's not a lot of money. I don't have enough to be a heavy beer drinker and pay $11. So I got a 12-pack for the first time in, like, almost forever. So it's pretty standard, but... my summer beer and watching soccer beer for the time being is the most widely consumed Hefeweizen probably in America, probably the world. I don't know, in America for sure. And that's that Paulaner Hefeweizen from Munich. And it's good when it's 60 and 70 degrees for sure.
All right. I got a 6-pack sample here. Blue Moon has put out a lighter beer called Blue Moon Light Sky. This comes in these 8-ounce cans, a 6-pack. Lighter version of the orangey Blue Moon taste. So probably, you know, I'm just going to buy the regular stuff if I'm in the blue moon mood, but this is not too bad. If you're trying to watch your calorie intake, try Blue Moon Light Sky, it's called. All right, let's take a quick break here, and we'll come back, talk 1984's Brother from Another Planet, and then we'll throw it around the room for a quick 2020 quick fix. Stay tuned. Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening to the Flixation Podcast. We are always happy to have you on board. Please contact the show anytime via email, flixationpodcast@gmail.com. Call or text our voicemail line anytime, 24/7. Leave your thoughts for the show or comments, 608-535-9302. Follow the show on Twitter @Flixation. You can get all of our episodes, even the old ones that iTunes no longer carries, at flixation.libsyn.com. That's LIBSYN. Flixation.libsyn.com. All of our episodes, all of the time. Or catch any one of our other number of podcasts available from members of the Flixation team, including the horror bi-weekly podcast, It's Only a Podcast, in-depth Twin Peaks talk and other things over at The Book House Podcast, a show about Twin Peaks, The Third Act Podcast, more general movie discussion for you, check that out. Be sure to check out We're Watching The Watchmen as we discuss the upcoming HBO series, The Watchmen. Thanks, everybody, again for listening to the Flixation Podcast, and check us out elsewhere. Have a good day. All right, welcome back to episode number 182 here. Let's discuss this film from 1984. This one's called The Brother from Another Planet, directed and written by John Sayles. A mute alien with the appearance of a black human is chased by outer space bounty hunters through the streets of Harlem. This one stars Joe Morton, Daryl Edwards, John Sayles, and an early performance here from our old friend David Strathairn. I guess my first question is, how did this come up, this film, Ian?
Well, it was kind of a lucky coincidence. We should get into John Sayles a bit, although I don't think we'll have much to say. But John Sayles was recently on the Michael Moore podcast, which I do not listen to, but my wife does. And she said, oh, he was really interesting. I'd like to watch one of his movies. And that never, ever happens here, almost ever. So in my house. So I was interested. And the reason it's on the show is I asked a couple people about John Sayles movies, and then Robert gave his list of movies he might be seeing in theaters this month, and there was this one on there, John Sayles one. So it was like the next day, and we kind of just he saw it, and that was it. That locked it in, because he gave he said it was worthwhile to talk about. But Sayles, he's kind of unknown to you, Eric. Completely?
Yeah, completely.
Okay. So my understanding of Sayles was very limited. He was just a guy that came up all the time, maybe in the way like a John Cassavetes does, not the same era. Cassavetes comes up with all your favorite American, like Italian-American directors, like Coppola and Scorsese, all of them and stuff. But Sayles seemed to be like this pre-indie boom indie director. But to me, my perception of him was that he was like an American Ken Loach. Like he made issue movies, like small, sad issue movies. Some of his character actors have a little broke into the mainstream and been really, really good. Like Chris Cooper and the guy you said, you just said, David Strathairn. Guys who are kind of character actors, but when they're in a big movie, they blow you away. But I had this perception of him as like a Ken Loachy guy. And I had only seen a movie called Lone Star with Chris Cooper. And this is does not fit into the Ken Loachy thing to me. But so he's always a guy I felt like I should be watching more. And after, yeah, the two I've seen, that's definitely the case. What was, I don't know, what was your thing with Sales, Robert? Anything?
No, I've never seen anything but this one. He made Eight Men Out, which I think is about the Chicago White Sox scandal. So that wouldn't make me think of Brother from Another Planet or Lone Star. I haven't seen that. Or Matawan. I haven't seen those, but they wouldn't remind me of the Brother from Another Planet. And I just caught this one. I had seen it come up on people's lists and stuff online. I thought maybe it was like in the blaxploitation genre, just based on like the cover and the title. I didn't really know what was going on, but I know a lot of people liked it. And then they showed it at a theater here for Black History Month, and they had a speaker come out and do some, you know, read some piece that he had written about the Black experience in America and what it feels like to be an immigrant and how this film is about a stranger in a strange land. So it was really kind of just cool to see it in the theater for the first time, and it was much different than I kind of expected, but I'll let you get into it to see if it was what you expected going in.
Yeah, and Sales, just to touch on, like, he seems like a very thoughtful guy. He's an author. You know, he's had success with film. It says, you know, I've dug very, very little, but it says basically he has made independent films, you know, since 1970, or it was like 1980 or 79 or something. So he's had a 40-some year career of this. And he basically has funded the entire thing by writing rewrites on like big movies or as a script doctor type thing. Like he wrote some stuff for Spielberg and things like that. But his passion was really to make these small movies. And that seemed to be what he wanted. That's all he wanted to do. He wasn't like using it to get to something else. Or even somebody like Spike Lee, who makes his own indie things. He then at times would make like the big movie for the studio. Sales didn't seem interesting in that, which makes me more interested to kind of dig into his stuff. And the fact that while there's lots of independent films, there's always been independent films to some degree. They were much less prevalent before maybe the very late 80s, early 90s. So it feels a little different than a lot of 80s movies you'll see. So yeah, the synopsis Eric gave was pretty good. Guy lands in New York. What does it say? He's on the run. Basically, he's an alien that looks like a black human, except for his feet have three toes. But we learn later he's being chased by some people. He's escaped slavery on another planet. He's in Harlem on the run. And that main character is played by Joe Morton, and he is mute. I don't know if he's mute. He doesn't speak. I can't remember if he makes any noises or not. But he's at the center of this thing, and he's this silent, kind-faced listener character. There's a lot of characters talking a lot, and he is obviously just taking it in, just a listener by default, basically. He has a gentleness to it. So he's a very easy character to immediately get behind for an audience. Really, like 100 minutes, 110 minutes, this film is. Really, as an audience, for me, all I wanted was for this wonderful character to just be okay. Like, he's dropped into this world he doesn't understand, and you just want him to be okay. And that's definitely not a given here. So I really didn't know what to expect. I thought this would be much... If I had expectations, I thought it would be much more, it's serious, but like, yeah, less playful.
Like heavy subject matter.
Look, yeah, because I thought he was a Ken Loach guy. So I thought this was going to be a hard look at like basically a slavery type movie, obviously set in the 80s, but alluding to that. And it's there, but it's much less heavy than expected. Yeah, 1984 indie movie in New York. That's awesome. This is right before or about the time Jim Jarmusch was starting. And there's plenty of differences, but there's some similarities that feel really great. The way you kind of fall into a that weird tone of a Jarmusch movie at times. This had some weird tones that I really liked, and not black and white. This one's plenty colorful. Jarmusch's early stuff was black and white, but another like 80s indie movie in New York. It's a really nice, I loved it. And I was surprised pretty much throughout. So it's very lightly and loosely plotted. There's a lot of course, he doesn't talk, but there's a lot of long conversational set pieces. You know, pretty early in the movie, he stumbles into a tavern, and I didn't know if the movie was going to leave that tavern because I knew it was such a small production. It ultimately does, but you spend a lot of time there. But yeah, long conversational set pieces and vignettes, almost vignettes. They're definitely connected, but it is really loosely plotted. The synopsis is essentially all the plot. Things happen, but that's really what it is. This is just a weird mix that really works that maybe you wouldn't think would. I mean, it's, as Sales says, and Robert kind of touched on, an immigration story. A man in a new land escaping, trying to start something new, doesn't speak the language, obviously, has literally nothing, looks like a man in like an escaped slave in tattered clothing. Yeah, but it's not like this realist, miserablest struggle that you might that I expected, at least. But also not like this happy, cuddly fairy tale. The tone's kind of fluctuating. It's got real danger. It does have struggle. We don't know he'll be okay, but it's always playful. There's like a kindness to people that you don't expect. If you expect, you know, like, if you think it's going to be a tough movie, you think every character is going to treat him like shit and kick him around and he has no hope. And he's, you know, there is kindness. There are decent people. There's a goofiness throughout. It's a fish out of water comedy to a degree. And then it's got this sci-fi element that I sure as hell, I guess, you know, his feet are weird early, but I don't know how much you expect the sci-fi element unless you've read about it. And it's very light early on, but increases later on. Like, our main character has powers. He touches things and can sense the past or what's happening or feel people's pain, almost like Superman, where you can hear everything. This guy can touch something and feel, I think, mostly pain, I don't know, or just the life of the city. He has the ability to fix things electronically just with his hands. This allows this character to survive, because otherwise, if this guy has no skills, no abilities, just tossed into a city, like, he's got no hope. So he has something, like many immigrants, they had a skill or something. And he has some kind of super strength, but not as super as the white guys, I don't think, or at least not two of them. It's also a man on the run movie, as we kind of, Eric mentioned in the synopsis, like, he's being chased by people from his planet who enslaved him. And in this film, it's two almost like Kids in the Hall level doofus white guys in all black before Men in Black, but Men in Black before Men in Black. And this is high comedy shit. They're just weird white alien dudes trying to navigate Harlem and getting basically the high hat from everyone they deal with, just being like shit on or like laughed at. And these two guys are played by David Strathairn and John Sayles himself. And this stuff is high camp comedy to me. Like, almost all of it is hilarious. And then the film's also a little bit of just the toughness of Harlem. There's a side plot of drug violence and wealthy white men preying on young black boys with drugs. I think it's heroin here. We have a drug overdose that our character witnesses. There is like an element to the black experience to this film with that, and also the black experience with what my favorite element of the whole thing is, and that's just this film as conversational hangout movie. I never liked it more than when we hung in the Black Run and frequented tavern that he stumbles into in the beginning and then returns to later. And then the people chasing him, the Men in Black chasing him, go back over and over trying to find him. this is just like a bunch of really interesting characters talking, reminiscing about the old days. The old guy talking about old Harlem when it was the place to be. The young guy playing pinball, bitching about the screen or bitching about the game not working. They're throwing a football around. They're just like weird stories, weird interactions, and our character being eyeballed, like, who is this fucking guy? And then there's an extended sequence that has nothing to do with anything other than it's funny, where a couple of dorky white guys from Indiana accidentally took the wrong train and stumble in there, and they're were they watching a Cubs game, or they're just obsessed with Cubs? I don't know. They just keep talking about Ernie Banks.
He just gets
Banks.
So drunk, he says he wanted. Yeah, he wants to be Ernie Banks, Mr. Cub.
I'm colorblind, man. But there's like, you just get like these black, like these these black guys in Harlem, like making fun of how weird these white guys are, and like, you're weirder than the other white guys. These are really funny scenes, and also like our main character. There's like a social worker type guy who sets him up with a place to stay, and it's this white woman's house who lives with the mother-in-law of her husband who left, who is an older black woman. And there's just funny scenes of our lead character just having to listen as people just give these long monologues about what life is like and all their problems and stuff. I really liked, when it was just that weird hangout movie. This thing's just packed with that guy actors that I don't know the names of, but I've seen in a million things, and it's wonderful versions of them. A good instance would be like the guy doing the card tricks on the subway. The scene has no purpose other than it's like a good actor who isn't given much chance to do much in other movies, but he's great in this, like a young version of an actor. I can't even remember. I should have looked up his name, but it's a really funny scene of him trying to do a card trick for this mute alien.
That's Fisher Stevens.
There you go. Yeah. And that's great. That's a really funny scene. So there's a lot to this, but I thought it was really, really fun and weird at times, playful, like campy. And it's just, it's interesting because it's really entertaining. But it's not a grand statement movie, but it has a hell of a lot to say while mostly entertaining you. Like, that seems to be the aim. I think it was just this really wonderfully woven together thing that I did not expect to be this good. So I liked it a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I loved it. I didn't expect it to be as funny as it was. I totally agree with the Jarmusch comparison. And Eric, I wonder if you agree that it felt like Leningrad Cowboys Go America, which is an Aki Kaurismäki film that I gifted to Eric for Flixmas 1 year, about strangers in a strange land and not being able to speak the language and getting into funny situations, and the people that live there don't know what to make of them. It has that vibe, but just like, it's just kind of giggling underneath the surface while also being kind of philosophical and kind of introspective. Early on, when the main character he just goes to a fruit stand and seems like he's eating a piece of fruit for the first time. And he's trying to figure out how to buy stuff and how the system works, how to be a black American in Harlem in the 80s, just having dropped in. That very much reminded me of a film we all saw together, Under the Skin, with Scarlett Johansson's performance as an alien, you know, not knowing how to eat or be around people, having to assimilate. Same arc here. It wouldn't surprise me if this film influenced Under the Skin. That's one we all love. I think it's on that level. It's just really interesting, that storyline. And he does assimilate by the end. He's wearing like a backwards Kangol and a suit, and he's down on Broadway, and he's like, it becomes like, I'm like, is this movie anti-capitalist? Well, no, he's just going to like a drug dealer's office. Like, he traced heroin. I think the heroin scenes are very like artistically done from Sales. I think it's an interestingly directed film, and the way he shoots, finding the junkie with a needle in his arm, seeing a guy that's like strung out dancing, but he's like doing an interpretive dance against a wall with graffiti, but it's all lit in like police blue. Just really interesting artistic choices. The way that bar is shot from like at least a dozen different camera positions and different lenses gives it different effects. I think it's really well directed. So I'm definitely interested in what sales has in his other genres, because I don't think any of the other films are like this, but he has technique that I like. And I agree with what Ian was saying about that bar. Every time they go there, it basically changes the tone of the film. Early on, when it hits that scene, it totally changes just because these guys are chatterboxes. And I love all those characters. Odell, the owner of the bar, his partner. I wish we got more of her. That motor mouth video game player. I love that deep voice philosopher, a guy named, Bill Cobb, I think is his name. He just has this great deep voice I could listen to forever. And he's just this kind of philosopher, giving advice about his wisdom, I guess. Yeah, those banal conversations in the apartment with like the 5-year-old kid and the granny. Most films would cut that out. This film keeps it in. I think it kind of flattens out in the third act. It kind of the storyline kind of fizzles, but it's not enough to like knock it down from the good vibes it's given. Yeah, a lot of the stuff that you mentioned. I liked all those characters and how everyone wants to keep him safe. Like the Jamaican guy, the nightclub singer, and on everyone's instinct is to protect him because he just seems nice enough once he's acclimated to like being in New York City in the 80s. And we get to see his healing power that he has on everybody around him, like keeping him safe. And he's healing people and his own foot. He like grows a foot. He heals a cut on his own hand. He fixes stuff. He sets the dog free from its leash on a parking meter. So it's kind of this reciprocal relationship. Like, and I like to think about, that's what it's thinking about, immigration, is that you got to look at how it shapes the community, all the benefits of it far outweigh any negatives that somebody could bring up. But I did wish it had a little bit, one more wrinkle in the third act that kind of put its hooks in me a little bit more, but it's kind of grasping at straws to find anything I didn't like about this movie. Eric, what'd you think?
Really enjoyed this film as well. The Men in Black thing, fantastic. I loved all the stuff. I don't know, I'm not big on this 80s revival stuff anymore, but this seems very 70s because this area is just kind of behind the times, based like financially and stuff. So like hanging out at the video arcade. They don't do it a lot, but I guess what I'll call superpowers stuff. It's very interesting how they intersperse it throughout this film. And obviously there's no budget here, so you have to be pretty sparing with it so it doesn't look terrible. But I think Sales does a really fantastic job of weaving this thing together at a minuscule budget, which I believe was about $350,000. It seems like a lot maybe in the 80s, but still very much not a lot of money. And it seems like he put together a pretty good cast here. I guess I'd have to look at where some of these people were with their careers at the time. And just maybe it was just kind of the start for a lot of these guys. But yeah, a lot of familiar faces here. It is very funny. It is fun to hang out in Odell's bar. I also loved the two white guys just kind of finding their way in there. I think it's very interesting how it kind of ties itself up at the end as well. So definitely had an ending that I didn't see coming. When you look back on like the graffiti and stuff, it is something that does, yeah, that was kind of brilliant. So yes, Sales and Straight There and as these Men in Black, it's pretty great. As they I love when the woman at the whatever department is telling them they have to fill out all this paperwork and whatever to get some answers. Good stuff.
Yeah, like good physical comedy there. So I think I kind of agree with Robert. It loses its way a little in the third act, but it amps up. Like, it has to tie up this story that doesn't really matter, but it does. So it amps up the camp and action to a really high degree, and it's really still very, very funny. Like, that fight scene in the bar where guys are getting down into like football stances and shit. Yeah, like that's really fun. Oh, yeah.
Throwing the cue ball. I'm like, yeah, that's a good move.
I know, Eric, you just watched this. So you're the most recent. You might not have anything to say, but I remember kind of liking it. But do you have anything, like, what was the soundtrack of this thing? Was it just goofy 80s stuff, or was there good stuff in there? Or?
Oh, I remember synthy stuff. Yeah, there was nothing really stuck out to me there. Synthy, like,
I watched
typical sci-fi, cheap budget score.
It's Calypso drum, like, whatever that, like, Bermuda drum, like that.
That's right.
That kind of drum. They use that a lot, like, when he's looking at the graffiti and, like, zoning out. It's like that weird calypso is the connection between
steel drum. Yeah,
there you go.
Steel drum. Yeah,
synth and steel drum.
There's at least one. You know, you just don't know because if you don't know the director very well and stuff. But there was at least one song choice that was either very corny or intentionally, like ironically bad. Like I just wish I could place it. That's what I was kind of thinking of. There's like a '80s tune that kicks in, and I just couldn't place it. But. One scene none of us touched on that I guess I haven't thought through what it means. I mean, it's not like some deep meaning, but I really, really like that scene where our lead here, he's given a job because they say he can fix things, and he's taken to a arcade where he literally just touches old, broken arcade machines with his hands and fixes them, and they have like a whole back room of them. But there's this girl who's so bored because she's so amazing at games that she can just put one quarter in and basically be so good that she never dies and the machine just breaks. So our lead here, she's just bored like playing this game, chewing gum, and he like puts his hands on the machine and they have this little conversation or a one-way one, but he like speeds up the game. Is she playing Space Invaders or something like that?
I don't have any idea what that was.
All right. She's playing this like shooting, like some kind of like spaceship shooting game. And he's able to speed up the game like at 100 times. And she's like, it's like the first, I don't know. It's like some kind of like drug high she's getting, like, or like almost orgasmic, like, her like head is spinning and her eyes are lighting up, and then it's like the first time she's ever had like the chance to play something where she couldn't dominate. I don't know what it was doing to her, but it was. I found that I'd like to think I'm going to think about that more. But there's something about that scene that really struck.
It plays like a prequel to Tron. This is the Tron. Our main character populates Tron.
Maybe
like, this is a very video gamey movie. Like this has enough video game movie like to be on a list of video game movies.
For sure, yeah. Yeah, there's something about that scene that didn't play campy or for comedy for me. It like some kind of like transcendent like action. I don't know. There was something there. But it's a really good movie that it can be this dopey plot that has all these little like nooks that it checks in with that feels so different. Like that has nothing to do with anything, but it's a scene that's probably gonna stick with me more than almost any of them. So in a different way than like guys crouching down into football stances and fighting and stuff. I don't think it's
like
that
earnest. It's not like
it's like, not like earnest? Cynical
either. Yeah, like that character that's like the social worker. The way he tries to get the brother out of his shell and stuff, and like the conversation with that girl is kind of like that silent conversation. The way he like gives people little mini therapy sessions without speaking. It's almost like the best of the 80s after-school specials. Like, there was a few, like, solid after-school specials. That vibe exists in this film. It's like, okay. It has that earnest after-school special kind of morality to it. It's not, like, cynical about its themes.
Wait, like, E-A-R-N-E-S-T?
Yes.
Okay, not, like, earnest, scared, stupid.
Not, earnest, not Jim Varney, no.
Oh, which is disappointing.
He's the remake.
Side note on Jim Varney, huge fan. When I was in maybe Eric had the same class, who knows? When I took German in high school, my German teacher had a poster of Jim Varney making like 50 different facial expressions, and then it said the German word for what each expression was. Huge influence on me. That guy's face. He's the pre Jim Carrey.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, this thing's great. I don't know how. I don't think it's that easy to see many of his films, but there's definitely a handful of sales films around, and now I'm really excited if they're, because this is nothing like Lone Star. Lone Star is like a very like slow moving, almost noir-y crime, like Texas crime thing.
All right, so that's The Brother from Another Planet. I rented it on Amazon. I don't know where else it is available, but that is an option if you're interested. So it sounds like we all say check it out for sure. All right, that sound means it's time once again for the quick fix. Other things we've seen that we want to talk about here on the Flixation podcast. I'll just throw it to everybody for one quick segment here. Let's start it out with the minister. Minister, what have you seen lately for the quick fix?
Yeah, well, people may not want to leave their house right now, so I'm going to give three very quick things that you can watch at home, at least in this country. I haven't seen a lot from 2020, but there's three things I really liked that I would recommend. So the very, very obvious one and the easiest one is on Netflix, and that is the short film by David Lynch called What Did Jack Do? Which is I think it was black and white. It is David Lynch as some kind of detective interrogating a monkey, a very small monkey, a monkey, I think. It's very small, about a murder, and it's like 20 minutes, and it's exactly what you'd hope it would be, really. No cruelty to animals here, but it is a monkey with a human mouth superimposed over the top of its face, and it's very, very funny. And it might be the best movie of the year at the end of the year. I don't know. Did you see that, Eric?
No, this is all news to me. Oh, so I will definitely be checking it out.
Yeah, that's great. Unfortunately, not on Netflix. She has stuff on Netflix, but Maria Bamford has a new stand-up special that you have to rent and pay money for. I don't think it's her best material. It's My Weakness is the Brand is the name. But she's so good. It's one of those things where the person is so funny that even if the joke doesn't always work, there's something about her delivery or her reaction to not working, the joke not working, or her, like, I don't know, the stuff between the jokes, her mannerisms, that this is, and a lot of the material is good too, but Maria Bamford, Weakness is the Brand, is, it's pretty great because she's great. And then, yeah, the movie. So there's this thing early in the year, every year, online, where it's called My French Online Film Festival. And they put like 16 French films on iTunes and Amazon for like a dollar or two. And then when it's over, a lot of them stay on if they don't have theatrical release and stuff. So this is a movie called School's Out by a guy named Sebastian Marnier. And it's a dollar on Amazon. And I think it's going to stay that way. And it's very, very, I don't know if it's great, but it's very good. It's the best movie, not short film or stand-up special I've seen this year. And it's like this, I'll really quickly just say what it is. It's about a substitute teacher who takes over for a teacher who in the classroom jumps out the window to his death. So he takes over this class where it's like this weird program where they put all the smartest students and they form this really close bond, and they're like 3 or 4 years ahead of everyone else in their school. Like they're in eighth grade or something, and they're seniors essentially, and they're very creepy. So you don't know, like, this thing feels like a horror film at times. It's a substitute teacher being mocked and ridiculed by these students. They have no emotion. He starts spying on them because they creep him out so much. And they're forcing each other underwater to hold their breaths for long periods of time. He sees them in fields beating each other. Just very weird stuff. It's a horror film, or you think it is. You're not sure what it is. That's kind of the appeal of this thing, is you're not sure what this is. And then, without giving anything away, it definitely ties much more into something that we as a world are dealing with and everyone should be dealing with and thinking about. And it takes a few turns. It's not perfect, but for a dollar French movie that's not going to show up anywhere else and no one's going to talk about, I'll tell you, early in the year, the movie called School's Out, it's the best thing I've found anyway.
All right, Robert, what have you seen?
I saw the gaslighting double feature of 2020, which is The Lodge and The Invisible Man, a couple of horror movies that I was interested in because they looked to both have similar themes, and they do, even though they're smart enough not to use the term gaslighting because that they're just about that. They don't need to call it out. But if you tell me, you know, or you ask me if I wanted to see Riley Keough star in a horror film and Elizabeth Moss star in a horror film, heck yeah, sign me up. Two great actresses that I think could play the hell out of that kind of scream queen kind of role. And they do. Unfortunately, I didn't really go for either of the films. The Lodge comes from the directors of Goodnight Mommy, which looked good to me, but I didn't see it. But I basically didn't like anything about The Lodge except for Riley Keough. And by the nature of what her character is, she's really hard to spend time with, even as good as she is in the performance. She's going crazy. You don't want to be around her. There is kind of a reveal that happens later in the film that only like halfway registered with me. I like had questions coming out of the screening, and so I wanted to like listen to what people thought, why it got good reviews, because I really didn't like The Lodge. But then hearing more about it and what people thought about that reveal and what it means in the end, I did bump it up a half star. So I give The Lodge 2.5, but I can't recommend it. I did like The Invisible Man, but I just think it's a kind of good for a horror movie. It is interesting to kind of focus the movie on what about the woman that's with the Invisible Man, the guy, you know, it's based on that old 1930s film with Claude Rains, but bringing it to the current moment. And so it's really interesting to watch, kind of look in the screen at the theater to find where the invisible guy is in the room. And there's lots of flowy stuff. You're waiting for stuff to move. Like it's really fun and really tense. But so I enjoyed it while I was watching The Invisible Man, but at the end, how it turns out made me really question stuff that I had seen before that, and it didn't add up, it didn't make sense, and it left a bad taste in my mouth. So I liked it, but only enough to give it a 3 out of 5. It just kind of bummed me out that I can't really trust horror movies in February, or I shouldn't say that. I feel like I can't really trust horror movies that aren't like Jordan Peele or A24, unfortunately. It's just, but I will still keep seeing the ones that intrigue me like these did. And the only other thing I'll mention is a movie called Invisible Life. I saw that in theater recently. It's a Brazilian film, and I think it's in the top 3 of the things I've seen so far this year. I give it a 3.5. It's about sisters in Rio that have a strong connection, and it follows them, spans a couple decades of their life, and how they kind of fall apart and reconnect. And just really good performances in Invisible Life.
Guys, that's going to mostly do it here for episode number 182. Stay tuned in a couple of weeks for episode 183. I don't know if you've had enough of the Oscars, but we are going to have a special Oscar show. Actually, we're going to be talking about a couple of films starring Oscar Werner. So, Jules and Jim and The Spy Who Came Into the Cold for episode number 183. Check us out. Once again, call or text the voicemail line 608-535-9302 or flixationpodcast@gmail.com. My name, Eric, H-A-Z-E-R, Hazer75 on Twitter. Thanks, as always, for listening. And then there's the minister. Thanks for joining us. I suppose I can just start calling you Ian again, right?
Yeah, whichever works. That is the name I've gone by from everyone other than on this podcast forever. So I will answer to it. And I don't know. I'm online, but Jesus Christ. Jesus, Eric, this fucking country. This fucking country, Eric, they're going to elect, they're going to, oh my God.
We are rejecting revolution. One hates to be on Twitter, right?
We We are rejecting revolution. We want regression. We want regressive brain dribbling out the ear. Fucking, oh God, our country's in trouble. But I want revolution. I have hope. I don't think it's happening. So I don't say much on Twitter because it's so fucking negative right now. And it deserves to be more negative than it is. And when your revolution is taken away from you, you should be very, very mean to people. So quit complaining. I'm going to be mean. If I'm on Twitter, I'm going to be very mean.
So yeah, tweet at him, get it started. Robert Gassaway, never mean on Twitter, Robert.
Yeah, but I'm not very active either, but I'm just as upset, but I just don't like to think about the stuff. So I don't follow it too closely. And now we have built an excuse to not go do stuff. Just say, sorry, I can't, coronavirus. So that's handy, at least.
I can't tweet coronavirus.
Sorry, I can't, coronavirus. But when I'm healthy, you can find me on Letterboxd and Twitter at Robert Gassaway.
And thanks, everybody, for listening. We're big fans of yours as you tune in to the program. Until next time, my name is Eric for Ian and Robert saying, we will catch you on the flick side.